We'll keep it short because he told me he needs you all the time he needs. Yes, the Backstreet Banker case, Ansel, take it.
Hello everybody, thanks for coming. Before starting, I will ask you to not take any picture and not discuss the subject on social media. It's a very long investigation and work on that case for almost 2 years, and there is a lot of investigation going on. So please, no picture, no social media. Consider everything as TLP Amber. If you need some data for working, use it, but please don't discuss that on social media. So, yeah. So this is me, Benoit. I'm French, living in Denmark and working for CSIS for 1 year now. And I'm working in the malware industry for around 7 years, I think. And I'm here to discuss a very funny case. So I will try to explain the internals of how the cybercrime industry works. So we are all trying to analyze different threats and understand how that works, but most of the time we get stuck at the binaries, or sometimes we can manage to have access to CNCs. But even a CNC, it's not enough to really understand what's going on behind the threat actor. So here, I've been very lucky. I was following a guy who works for a long time in the carding business, and that guy made a huge mistake, and he leaks a huge amount of private intel regarding his old business, and I will try to present here a little bit how that works. So today, I will talk mostly about carding. When I say carding, it's every way you can find for frauding a bank, making money via internet, basically. And today, the carding business, it's insanely successful. Those people make a huge amount of money. It's millions of euros and dollars. For fun, I was discussing with a carder, a French carder, the guy who was developing TinyNuke, so he's now. And that guy one day tells me that he stole around €500,000 in 2 years, and he said, I'm a small player, and this is nothing compared to the whole business. I'm just a small player. So it's very impressive. They are very successful. It's a very well-structured organization. So they work as, it's a huge market, the whole bank fraud and online fraud, it's a huge market. You can consider that as the antivirus market or the security market. For the security market, you have clients who want to be secure. For the carding market, you have clients who want to steal money. And so they go to that market. You have a bunch of products, different malware, everything you can imagine to fraud a bank. And you just pay, and you have access to different products, and you can fraud and being rich very quickly. So I will try to explain that. And for that, I will use, so that guy I was following, so that guy, I call him Bagzu, it's not his real name, but I use that nickname because it's easier for me to work. That guy is working in the carding industry since 2005. I know that because I've managed to read a discussion between him and his partner, and they were discussing the good old time, and it's around 2005. I try to put some event in the cybercrime industry just to explain how old is that guy. That guy was here before Gozi, he was here before Zeus. Nikita Kuzmin get arrested, he's the manager of Gozi, so Bagzu survived to Gozi. Even recently, he was there before Drydex, before Trickbot, he was there before everything. So it's a very, very old carder who has probably huge connection everywhere. And it's, yeah, very interesting. And for that talk, the data I've managed to retrieve, it's only, yeah, the last 2-3 years. So I don't know what's happened during the last 15 years because that guy steals money in Europe for 15 years. He only targets Germany. He loves Germany. It's another subject. But yeah, I only have data for the last 3 years. So Bagzu is basically a carder, but he's a carder is never alone. It's always a carding operation. So it's one guy leading different partners, and those partners work together to make money. And Bagzu is one of the coordinators of that carding gang. Just quickly, you have two versions of Bagzu, kind of. So I was following him in 2018, and at the end of 2018, he changed completely his business, and something new happened. I will explain, it's super interesting. But before that, I will go quickly because it's kind of boring. So it was very an old school carder. He was running everything himself, hosting his stuff. He was using his own malware, so it's a Pony and now Azurult. So it's very old, a password stealer, it's open source now. So he used this very, very old school malware. He also used a modified version of Zeus. So Zeus leaked in the wild I don't remember when, but he takes the code and modifies different stuff. He pays somebody, a developer, to modify different stuff, I will explain. And with this action, he will use the WebInject and the VNC and the proxy socks to fraud the victims. And since at least 2014, I have traces from 2011, he's managed to move from a Windows to Android to pwn the Android and bypass two-factor authentication. That guy, so before September 2018, he always used domains more than IPs. You have to hide your IPs. So for that, he used a fast flux. It's not a fast flux, but those guys sell that as a fast flux. It's called Brazzer. It's a very famous fast flux today. You have TrickBot, you have Yadzeus, you have some OSX malware, Azurult, you have Carding Shop, you have everything behind this kind of fast flux, and Bagzu is very friend with them, and he works with them. Just for fun, so when I've tried to look around Brazzer, I've tried to de-anonymize some domain, and the more domain I was de-anonymizing, I just realized that everything is hosted on the same AS, by the same hoster, not everything, but most of the stuff. And it's an AS, it's called Morenhost, and it's pretty fun because that guy sell access to the server on the same forum as Brazzer, so basically they work together. And it's not a bulletproof because I've managed to discuss with the admin of Morenhost, and basically he say, if you send me an abuse, I will reply, and I will send the abuse to my client. And the deal is that if I receive an abuse, I ask to the client to pay more, and if he refuses to pay more, I kill him. So it's kind of abuse scam, but that guy actually replied to scam, to abuse, and sending abuse make, you just make the threat actor lose a little bit of money, so it's still something funny to do. So at that time, the Bagzu was only using ExploitKit because spam is very noisy, a lot of different attack vectors are very noisy, so Bagzu like staying feud. So he used ExploitKit. Big thanks for Caffeine, he helps me a lot. Caffeine knows a lot of things. And we found some traces of Bagzu using already Angular ExploitKit in 2016. And he moved to different client, Rig ExploitKit, and recently Fallout, and now he's even around some spillable reseller. And the fun story behind the ExploitKit, the move between different products. So I've managed to intercept a conversation between one of the Fallout operator, Fallout ExploitKit, and Bagzu. And it's the whole discussion where it's the first contract they have signed together. So the discussion takes 3 days. The first day they discuss what's up, who are you, where you come from. Second day they start testing. So Bagzu is providing a binary, Rig ExploitKit, Fallout is spreading the malware in just a few bots. They try to see if everything works. And for that case, the binary wasn't working for any reason between the exploitation and the binary. Something was wrong with the packer of the binary. And it's pretty fun because it's a developer from Fallout ExploitKit who came to the discussion and he said, I can help you. He take the binary, modify some stuff on the crypt, and the developer from Fallout ExploitKit helped Bagzu. And after 3 days, everything was working. And I saw that for 1,000 infection in Germany with Fallout ExploitKit, it's $600 before the spread and $600 after the spread. And they just pay by Bitcoin. So it's very easy. And after the ExploitKit, so he dropped Pony. Pony is used for stealing password, but also for dropping another binary. So this is a very typical Pony, nothing very fancy. Targets only Germany. The second stage is Zeus, so it's a modified version of Zeus. Basically, he supports more browser because now you have to support Windows 10 and all the stuff. This is very old. You can reserve .bit domains. Fun story, he was testing his bot and on one browser, so the browser had AdBlocks installed, and his WebInject CNC was actually blocked by AdBlock, not a security product, but the domain was blocked because he was on the malware list of AdBlocks. So he had to pay a guy for developing a little module to auto-wipe himself in AdBlock. And the VNC module is basically, he stole the source code of Kperp and the guy developed a little bit around, and that's it. That whole operation, from what I read in Jabber, the whole operation runs around 10 years. And in 10 years, he said that he paid around $100,000 for every development around this. So it's a lot and not a lot because it's on 10 years, 100,000, it's like nothing for him. So I don't know if it's a lot. After that, he used Zeus, he inject your browser, he will prompt a web inject to steal money. The web inject are only targeting Germany because that's how Carder works. There is some fantasy around the carding business. A carder, if he wants to make money, he needs to use different techniques to bypass the security the bank security, and you need to know which country you target. You need to know the culture. You need to know which bank is famous. When they update the website, you need to update the web object. So most of the carders, they focus on only a few countries. And Baxo is like this. He's focused on Germany. That guy covers more than 700 German URL banks. That's huge. I've never saw that before, and it's huge. And he runs that for like 15 years. So he used the exploit kit. That's something I forgot to say about Rig Exploit Kit. A fun story. So he was client of Rig Exploit Kit, and he moved to Fallout. And he was discussing with Fallout, and he said, "My biggest problem with Rig Exploit Kit is that those people are very good, but they spread the rogue ads mostly on very shitty pornographic website." And he said, "I'm running a banking Trojan operation. I need people with money, and people like getting infected in some shady pornographic website, it's mostly poor people and I don't have money, so I have a lot of infection but I can't do anything with it." So he moved to Fallout to try to have something else. This is the kind of challenge that you have to deal with in cybercrime. So he used the exploit kit, he dropped Pony for stealing your password because you need different password to commit a fraud, he inject your browser for retrieving the bank credential, he installed VNC because today if you want to fraud a victim, a bank account, you need to use the same computer. So you need to be via VNC or whatever. There is no magic, because there is a lot of heuristic in the bank side, you need to use VNC. VNC is a huge business in the carding industry. Nobody really cares about that, but VNC is very, very important. VNC and a residential IP proxy is something huge today, and it's a very huge business. But even with all of that, today it's not enough for really stealing money, because most of the people, they have two-factor authentication on the smartphone, so you need to bypass the two-factor authentication. So how do you do that? When a victim is infected by Zeus, so you have the web inject appearing, he has a specific CNC, and he configured the web inject for any victim who went on his bank account. The web inject prompts an image saying, "If you still want to access to your bank account, you need to install our new security app, and it's not on the App Store for any reason." And they propose you three ways to install it. You can receive an SMS, who really looks like a German bank SMS. You can scan a QR code with your smartphone, and the last one, they even explain how to use ADB plugged by USB and install the APK. And it's very successful, and the APK is mostly used for intercepting any two-factor authentication, and that guy fraud specific payment system in Germany called Sofort and Giropay, and you need to touch the smartphone for paying, but I will explain later. So let's sum up. So Baxo used the exploit kit, he dropped on it, Zeus, everything stole every credential, he managed to have VNC access, he can commit some fraud. But in 2019, this is very old, and for him, that cost him a lot of time to maintain every product, make the CNC run, have no crash, update the binaries, and it's not even a money problem, it's a time problem. It's too huge for him and his team to manage to that. So he has to move to a new kind of business, and it's actually pretty funny because I was monitoring that guy again and again, and it's September 2018. So one of his partners start discussing. It was a VNC reseller, and they discussed about life, and at the end, Baxo tell him, "You know, something very big is coming, so let's see, and you will see something very big is coming." And I get thrilled because it's like very interesting to me. So I start looking around, and month after month, I managed to retrieve information from the testing machine of Baxo, because Baxo use almost 20 different VM with different version of the browser, the different version of Windows, different Kibi install and stuff. So I managed to have some information from his VMware computer. And I managed to retrieve this screenshot. And if you work in the banking Trojan industry, it's pretty obvious. You have two domain resolution and an HTTP request. This is a GOSI HTTP request. And it's pretty cool because GOSI today, so long story short, GOSI, the manager was arrested, but the source code leaked, so you have many fork around. Like your sniff is dead 20 years ago, but now it's all you. You have GOSI, Dreamboat, everything. Different version of GOSI. And for me, it's pretty big to see that because I'm like, that guy runs to GOSI, and GOSI is mostly crime as a service. So you don't run anything. You pay, they give you access to some stuff. So for me, it's very interesting. And I start digging, and I found his CNC, his Gozi CNC. And in fact, it's Gozi plus Tor. So it's called DreamBot. It's a famous botnet called DreamBot. He made around 500,000 infections between October and August only around Germany. And his main target is Germany, but also Canada, USA, Poland, India, Japan. I will explain later why. After digging, I saw that that guy is also client of TrickBot. So he's paying TrickBot, he managed to have access. Each time you see a TrickBot in Germany with the G tag, GBA1, GBA2, GBA10, this is Bagzu, this is nobody else, this is Bagzu paying TrickBot to infect German client. Because TrickBot is just a crime as a service. You call them, you say, I want German bank data, and they say, no problem, and they spread, and you have access to a nice panel, and you can retrieve the bank data. That's how the cybercrime works today. And he's also a client of Emotet, and that's awesome for me because, so Emotet, you can do a lot of things with Emotet, but same, Emotet is a crime as a service. Emotet, you call them and you say, same, I have a malware, I want to drop a malware in Germany, but I don't want to use spam because spam is too noisy, exploit is too expensive. So you call Emotet and you say, I want to drop 10,000 bots in Germany. Can you do that for me? Emotet say yes, you pay, and they drop for you. And after this summer, Emotet was back, and they have started first spreading in Germany, and it was TrickBot, GTAG, GBA2, so it's Bagzu paying Emotet for dropping TrickBot. And for me, it's pretty funny. And he also has his own crime kit, so he tried to resell the crime kit as a service, like TrickBot is doing, but it was a big failure, so now he has moved to something else. But he has tried, so it's pretty fun. So this is one of his DreamBot CNC. So what's pretty interesting to me is that so after this summer, Emotet was back and he tries first to spread TrickBot by Emotet. But everybody was looking at Emotet and TrickBot at that time. And trust me, it was almost impossible to really make a lot of infection by TrickBot via Emotet. I follow Bagzu, and 5 days infect less than 500 people via Emotet and TrickBot, and that's ridiculous. So there is some trouble with TrickBot right now and Emotet. So he switched the payload, he switched TrickBot by DreamBot, and DreamBot in 3 days he managed to infect almost 20,000 people. So DreamBot works very better, and in my opinion, it's because everybody is looking at Emotet spreading TrickBot, so the combination of both IOCs on the computer are blocked by every AV today, and it's very hard to have a good load rate, so it's pretty impressive. What I want to show also is that, so this is still the DreamBot CNC, and you can see that every bot, almost every bot, has different command. Carding is not a magic business. There is no magic button you push and you become rich. That doesn't work like this. You infect a lot of people and you have to check manually every bot, which one is interesting, which one can allow me to steal money or not, and it's a very long job. And that's why you need to hire people, and that's why a carder never work alone. Here, for example, you have G25. It's a fraud monkey he pays, and that guy is responsible for frauding every Amazon account, for example. And Bagzu deal with 500,000 infections in a few months. Alone, it's impossible to do that. So this one is awesome. This is the TrickBot backend. So when you pay TrickBot, they give you access to that panel. And you can access to the specific GTAG you have paid for. GTAG, but you can also say, I want to have access to this company. And you have an Active Directory search engine. You search the company, and TrickBot gives you a price. You pay, you have access to the company. That's how Ryuk is playing today. It's very easy for them. They just browse and up, run the malware, and it's pretty easy. And so this is his TrickBot CNC, and you can see the GTAG RGBA1 and everything. So I've tried to look on Twitter and try to see if somebody have already catched Bagzu and discuss about him. I found that tweet very recent about Certboon saying, be careful, TrickBot is pushing Rogue, Avast, APK via the web inject. So this is Bagzu playing. I see him doing that for years. Vitaly, this is the only tweet I found before this summer showing that actually Emotet was dropping DreamBot and nobody was caring about that, but he made 500,000 infection and nobody saw anything, and that's pretty awesome for me. And this is Bagzu again. And what looked like very unrelated, last week Emotet was in Japan back and they were spreading DreamBot, and the DreamBot, you can follow DreamBot because each client have a specific EES key. And this is the ES key of Bagzu. And I was like, what the fuck? Bagzu is working in Germany. He cannot card Japan. That doesn't work like this. It's too complicated. So I have some trouble to really understand the big pictures. And after digging and digging and digging, I finally understand that Baxu is client of Emotet. And Baxu, today, he runs two businesses. He frauds the bank, he's a carder, and he's also a loss reseller. A loss reseller is somebody that's like TrickBot. You call him, I want 10,000 infection, give me the 10,000 infection. So he's paying Emotet. Emotet spread in Japan, Poland, Italy, Germany for him. He spread DreamBot and TrickBot. And on the DreamBot CNC, you can see that he split different countries to different clients, and he prompt different web injects for different clients. And you can see that, for example, for Japan, so Baxu is spreading DreamBot in Japan for somebody else, but he prompt the web inject of the guy in Japan. And when you look the web inject and you do some analysis, you look around the crime industry, and you realize very quickly that that guy is also paying somebody else to spread Ramnit for prompting his web inject, Zeus Panda, Danabot, and also Deus Action, the Baxu stuff. So Baxu is reselling loads to a guy frauding Japan via different malware. And that's very curious to me, because why he's doing that? And I have two conspiracy theories. The first one is that Emotet have a number of slots open. So you pay Emotet, they say, I have 50 slots. The first one who is there pay and have access. And now Emotet doesn't have any slot open again. So Baxu have one, so Baxu like re-resell the bots from Emotet for another guy. I don't know if it's legal for Emotet or not. And my second conspiracy theory is that Baxu is friend with one of the Emotet operator, and he managed to have a very low price for Emotet, so he's reselling more expensive the very low loads that he managed to buy behind. And that's very interesting, because that's how the carding and the malware business industry works today. And we are all focused on the binary part, because that's what we are seeing. But behind a binary, it's a whole industry. And when we try to do attribution, like if you want to do attribution with Emotet, it's a real nightmare, because you have plenty of people behind. Behind Baxu, you have different frauders. Behind DreamBot, you have teams of developers, operators, same with TrickBot. It's honestly, it's companies. TrickBot, DreamBot, the exploit kit, everything, Ramnit, it's different company, it's a market, and you pay them, they have different actors, and they help you. And it's pretty impressive. And Baxu was also using Emotet to spread DreamBot and TrickBot to fraud Germany, because he still needs money to fraud Germany. But stealing money from, stealing credential from a bank account is very easy. But stealing the money, that's the very hard part. Cashing out the money, that's the very hard part. But Baxu is super smart. I saw him using different project management software. He knows exactly where he has to click, how to do, how he has to reset the cookie and stuff. It's pretty impressive. And I saw him cashing out the money in three different ways. So he cashed out via package drop. I will show later when he fraud eBay, Amazon. He pays some people, like cash out as a service, which is a big thing in the internet. And he also runs his own Monemule network. So the cash out as a service, it's pretty easy. So he managed to hack somebody, company. He want to cash out 50K, let's say 50K. He go on Jabber, different forum. He say, who can cash out 50K from Germany now for me? Somebody reply. And I know that he was working with that guy, Mek, because Mek is very specialized in Germany. They are friends together. And he's known for cashing out in Colombia. And when I've digged the data, I found a bank transfer in Colombia, in Medellin. So he's really cashing out with that guy, and I can see the money going in Colombia. The second way is to, like, he pay a services, so he managed to access to a lot of Amazon account, eBay account, he pay a guy, that guy just log in every Amazon account, and he log in to that panel too. For Amazon, you need to bypass some geolocalization restriction. You cannot, like, connect to a German account, order stuff from Russia, it doesn't work like this. So he used that panel. On that panel, you go on that panel, you have a list of Monemule, and you say, I want a Monemule in Germany, in Berlin, near that street. And in the huge list, you just select the nearest to your victim, and you send the package to that person. That person sends the package to another person, another, another, another. At the end, one group collects every packages, and they resell the packages in different illegal markets. Like, we all know that some stuff that are very cheap and not supposed to be cheap, this is carding goods, and this is very common. And when you're a carder and you send packages to this kind of services, I know that you can expect, depending of the package, you can expect between 10 and 40% of the price of the package. So you have to do a huge amount of fraud for having good money. and he has his own fraud washing machine. So basically, he hired different people around Ukraine and Germany. He has a money mule manager, and that money mule manager organized everything. He takes the money from Germany, he sends the money around in Germany. The money go to Ukraine. In Ukraine, you have people creating fake company for having business credit card, and they receive the money on the fake company bank account. They run to the ATM, take the money, the cash, and the money is gone. And it's kind of easy for him. And when you're a carder and you fraud different banks, so like Bagzu, I saw him sometimes he fraud 5K, sometimes less than 1K, depending on the victim. Sometimes, yeah, 8K, that can be more. I saw around 6-5, 10K, another 10K. There is a big things around the carder that like saying that they are Robin Hood, they steal the West, but they are good people, that doesn't hurt. It's fine to card people. This is a command in Russia in the Android CNCs, and the guy just write that victim receives his salary between the 21 and the 27 every month, so rob that guy every time he receives his salary. And this was random people in Germany. So that's not Robin Hood, you know. And they don't really care, and they take the money where they can take the money. Sometimes you hack a company, and you have access to this kind of bank account with like multi-million euro available, but you cannot like send 1 million in one bank transfer, so you have to be creative to find a way to fraud the bank. It's very interesting. And you have also, it's not only the bank, so he infects a lot of people with DreamBot, and he looks, you can see here, he saw, oh, this is a POS in a hotel. So I think it's 6 days later, you can see on the right, 6 days later, he dropped a second stage, so in an attribution and forensic point of view, it's a fucking nightmare, but he waits 6 days, drop another malware, I don't know which one, and he has spawned the POS and make money like this. So I've been very lucky, and during a couple of months, I've managed to monitor one of his personal money mule network, and it's between December 2018 and March. It's only the money stolen in Germany. I don't know what's happened outside. And I've only taken the money. I'm sure the money was cash out. So it's a probably very low estimation. And in 4 months, it's 600,000 euros. So that looks not that big, in fact. It's big, but not that big. But when you think about other crime, you have people robbing, gas station with a gun, like taking the risk to kill somebody for 5 grand. And that guy is able to make half a million in, probably a lot more than half a million in 4 months without, you know, really doing a lot of things. He's just paying, he's just about investing money in different products, receiving the money. I've also catch one of his Bitcoin wallets. So you can see it was last year, the Bitcoin was at 4 grand, now it's 9 grand. So even without doing anything, he made a huge amount of money. I will go quick, I'm sorry. This picture is pretty fun, I love it because I was following that guy, and when you follow a criminal, and you see that guy managed to steal million and million and million from the Europe, you're like, who's that guy? Is that like Pablo Escobar, full of cocaine and war and stuff? What's happened? Who's that guy? And I found this picture, and I'm almost certain that it's Bagzu taking these pictures. You can see that he looks like a random guy drinking in plastic glasses and smoking random cigarettes and stuff. It doesn't look like Pablo Escobar. And I was feeling good that seeing this is something fun, you know. Because you always think, who's that guy, what he can do, what power he can have. And I will just go, I'm sorry I'm late, but I will go quickly. This is something we all forget, we never think about that. But in every cybercrime operation, there is a huge part of the operation, this is offline. They work together. Offline is, it's difficult offline because doing everything online is very nice because you have nobody that can kill you, basically, if you have a good OPSEC. And offline is very different because if nobody knows you, he can basically kill you. And I have a fun story around that. So this is a guy coming to Bagzu. It's an old partner they know together a little bit. But that guy came at some point and he said, I want to create a new partnership. I want to make more money. Let's work together. And they discuss, and the guy say to Bagzu, by the way, I have a huge trouble. I need your help. So he started to explain that guy is not from Ukraine, so he cannot act inside Kiev or whatever, so he asked for help to Bagzu, and he said, my ex-partner was working with me, and he ripped me for 250,000 euros, so he ripped me, and I'm pissed off because that's a lot of money, and I'm not aware of how that works in Kiev, but can you send somebody for me? This is the address of the guy, the nickname, he runs a shop, a car shop in Kiev, and I want you to go there, and first ask for the money, and if the guy say no, he say the expression right was beat him until the end. So this is a real crime. Those guys, they don't fuck around, and if you steal them, they will kill you, you know? And they don't really care. And they have a lot of offline connection in different countries. They know each other. It's a core group of people working together, stealing an insane amount of money. And yeah, and they don't joke around, and they work offline. I saw that Bagzu was paying holidays to his money mule, and he go to Spain with his money mule every year. So there is an offline. And just to conclude, this is the big picture of how I see the crime industry today. And we are all focusing on the part botnet, phishing, scam. We know that very well, how they inject process and stuff. We know that very well. But outside that, we don't know anything. And in my opinion, I like saying that if we compare how we deal with cybercrime that with how we deal with a murder, for example, focusing and spending all the money on the botnet, it's like if you have a murder with a gun and you spend all the money and your time studying the brand of the gun. That's interesting, but that's not what we have to look for if we want to stop cybercrime. Because even if you kill a botnet, you have thousands of botnets and they will get back and it's a huge business. I saw some discussion between Bagzu and the guys from Gosnim. They were arrested by Europol. And trust me, on Jabber, they were all laughing and they say it's fine, nothing will happen and we will get back in 6 months. The product, they don't care and it's a market that works and it's very hard to kill. What we have to kill, it's the carder, it's the people providing the money to the market, in my opinion. And so those carders, they just buy different products, some spam exploit kits, and for each product you have different company around. An exploit kit need traffic, so you need traffic resellers, so you need people stealing traffic. For spammer, you need people sending spam, you need bots. It's a whole industry, you need developer. And when you pay those people, you pay with dirty money, so you have to cash out the money for them. It's a huge market, very close. It's very, very complex, and I've tried to explain a little bit how that works better with Bagzu. I hope I've been clear, because I'm obsessed with that case, so sometimes it's difficult, but that's how the cybercrime industry is working today. So, that's it. Thanks for your time.